Hi there folks, in today's demonstration I want to show you how we can use an object instead of a switch in Power Automate. Or maybe you've come across trying to use nested if statements, which can get quite complex. So an object is quite a simple idea, but using expressions we can query data from that object directly, and if we really want to, we can actually use an external data source like a list to create an object that allows us to query that data dynamically. So within the demo today, I'm going to show you an example of a Microsoft form with some options, and with those options we'll then retrieve a value, and I'll also show you within Power Apps how we can do that too, but also I'll show you how we can configure that data source. So starting from the beginning, I'm going to add a compose action, and within that compose action I'm going to paste in an example of an object, and you can see we've got three options. Now I want to return the values, the turkey, the beef, or the vegetable medley, based on the option that's made. So if I add a compose above, and we can call this the compose option, and in there we can put a string like option one, and then in a step afterwards we'll add another compose, and with that we'll call that our result, and we'll now build an expression, and that expression is going to use the string in that option to return the value within this compose, which is an object, so we should get the value turkey returned. So in our expression tab we are going to insert a space, and that will allow us to go back to dynamic content and then choose the compose, which is our object. So there we can see the outputs of compose. Then we're going to insert a question mark and some square brackets, and then within that square brackets we're going to choose the compose option. And so what this will do is it will return our value, so in this case turkey. So just to prove that, we'll put it into test, we'll manually run it, and in a split second we'll get to see our value returned in the history. And there we have it, we've got turkey. So if I was to go into edit and change this to option 3 and test and save and test, we should hopefully get vegetable medley. And you're probably thinking, okay, that's great, but within a switch we have a default value. Well, I'll demonstrate that in a second too. So we can see now we have vegetable medley. So if I go into edit once more, and if I put in option unknown and we run this test, this is when we'd expect to have a default value. And this is also why it's important to insert a question mark in your expression. So the compose result right now is null, empty. There's nothing actually to download. If I was to go into edit, and if I take out that question mark and hit update and we test it, my flow will actually fail because it won't find the option unknown in my object. So here we go, my flow run has failed. So first of all, it's very important for this particular solution that we include the question mark, and then what we're going to use to our advantage is an expression known as coalesce. So if I type in coalesce with an opening bracket, and what coalesce does is it returns the first non-null value from a list of items. So the first one is going to be the dynamic value from our compose based on the string. Our second one is going to be our default option, which is chocolate. That sounds like a good option. And we'll hit the update, and I very much expect now the option of chocolate to be returned. And this is just to explain really the concept of objects and expressions within Power Automate before we jump into the bigger picture. So our result now is chocolate. One last thing I'd like to do, if I change this back to option 2, I'm gonna change this to beef pie, and we'll test it. I would, of course, expect the result of this expression now to return the value beef pie. There we go. So with that, I'm going to now use that to our advantage with a Microsoft form. So you can see within the Microsoft form, I have three options, 1, 2, and 3, very much like the three options in the first solution. And then I have a brand new flow here, which is based on when a response is submitted, based on that form, and getting the response details, which hasn't loaded up properly, there we go, with the response ID. So as before, I'm going to go into new step, go into my clipboard, and I just so happen to have that object in my clipboard, so we can see the turkey, beef, and vegetable medley. And if I add another compose, I can then build an expression to get that result. So we'll just call that compose result. I'll go into my expression, I'll add a space, I go back to dynamic content, I can select compose, and with that, again, I can put in my question mark, my square brackets, my not single quotes, and then the answer to my question. So this dynamic value here. Hit OK. We'll go ahead and test that. And then I'll make a selection from the Microsoft form. And based on that answer to my question, we will then return a value from this compose, which contains the object. So we'll make a choice of option 2, hit the submit button. And hopefully in the result, we can see the option of beef, which is of course based on this object. So now what I'd really like to do is demonstrate how we can use a dynamic data source. So our data source in this occasion is going to be a SharePoint list. And you can see that I have a title that has the values of option 1, 2, and 3. We have Xmas dinner for our turkey, beef, and vegetables, but I also have some other data which should hopefully inspire you with some ideas, for instance, with approvals or sending emails or messages to teams. You can make your data dynamic and don't need to rely on switches. So jump back into this flow, into edit. I'm now going to delete these compose actions because we're not going to use these in our solution. We're going to build a dynamic solution based on that list. And with that, we're going to look up the get items action. So the get items, we need to, of course, tie to our SharePoint site. We need to go and pick our list. And then just a little tip or trick. If I have a look at this flow checker, currently, I expect at least there to be an error. There we go, about get items, because potentially I'm going to retrieve an awful lot of items. But a little trick here is if we put a forward slash in and do our check again, it should clear that error. So there we go. On to the next step then. So my next step is all about initializing a variable, and that variable is going to be used to store our new object. So we can call this our options object, and then we can set the type to an object, and we also need to initialize the default value, which is our empty object, as you can see there with the squiggly brackets. Then what we want to do is to use an apply to each, and that apply to each is going to loop through all the items on our list, and we're going to repurpose the data. So I'll pick value, which is my list of items, and then I've got two actions in this apply to each. The first option is my compose, and that compose is going to be used to retrieve a copy of this variable. Now the reason I do that is because in the next action, we're going to set the variable. And it's important to note that you cannot turn on concurrency on this particular solution, because if you do, we're going to end up with an object that's incorrectly constructed. We'll overwrite it. We'll get into a right mess. So do not turn on concurrency. So what we're going to do now is, using a copy of that particular object in our variable, we are going to update that variable using another expression. So the expression we're going to use now is called addProperty. Now, it might not make much sense at this point, but when we play back the history, I'll explain it in more detail. So addProperty is going to take our dynamic content, our compose, which is a copy of our variable, and it's going to add a new key and a new value. So if we have a look back at our original flow, a key is this thing here, and our value is this thing here. And what I want to do is I want to repurpose the data from our SharePoint list so that our title becomes our key and our value actually becomes the whole item. So every single piece of data within that item. So the first part is the key. And if we type in the expression, the item, open close brackets, a question mark, and our square brackets with single quotes, we can type in the word title, and that will retrieve our title column here, which will give us the option 1, 2, and 3. Then, in terms of the value, we simply want to return the item, as in the whole item. and that will give us a lovely repurposed object that we can use to dynamically retrieve the information. Then, outside of this apply to each loop, I can now look up the value. So if I use another compose, we can call that result, and we're going to create an expression. So into the expression, using a space, and then using that variable, we're going to then use a question mark, square brackets, and again, just insert that question, the dynamic value from question, which will of course allow us to look up that new object that we've created. Now, I'm going to do this twice, and the reason for it is to demonstrate the difference here. So if I just select this whole thing, I'm just going to Control C, so I've got a copy of that expression, say OK, I'm going to do a new step and add in another compose, and I'm going to call this compose Xmas dinner. So into the inputs, into the expression, I'll paste in that expression from the compose above, and the difference this time is at the very end, I'll put a question mark, I'll put in some square brackets, some single quotes, and I'm going to reference the column name, because our first example, remember, is going to use the whole item as that value. We want to target the Xmas dinner column, so within my expression, I type in Xmas dinner and say OK. So now that that's set up, if I go ahead and test, then we can jump back onto that Microsoft form and make a selection and see if we can return our dinner option. Right, that's the flow running. We'll go to submit another response. We'll choose option one. Back to our flow. Now remember, the flow is going to query that list. Still relatively quick, to be honest. And if I look at the Christmas dinner, we can see that it's returned turkey. If I look at the result, you can see that actually it's returned everything within that list item. And that's what I mean. So we have used or extended the expression in the latter compose here to reference the Xmas dinner key, and that has returned turkey. Similarly, we can reference the approvers, but you'll note that the approvers are actually in an array, and you have the email. And as we work our way down, we'll see other examples. We've got some text and we've got some number, so we can reference them by using the same format for the expression here by simply adding question mark, square brackets, and single quotes. Now, the other great thing about this is, because it's completely dynamic, if I was to go and edit this and say we have a beef pie, and exit out of that, so it's saved. If I then put this flow back into test mode again and go down the route of choosing option two in my form, so we'll just submit another response, make sure this is waiting. And if I select option two and I submit, jump back into my flow, we will now see beef pie. So how about that? The dynamic content in an object that we've created. The final example is all based on this Power App. So I have a Power App, I have a drop down, and it has three options. And these options could, of course, be dynamic too, based on the SharePoint list. So as you add items into that list, your items here will increase, but they're currently fixed. And like before, it's going to pass an option to a flow, and then use that option to look up the object based on that SharePoint list and return the approvers, some text, and some number. So the button is all about running a flow. My flow is called Power App Conditional Flow, and you can see I have a drop down called Drop Options, and I'm passing that selected text. I'm storing the result of that flow in a variable, and then I'm using that variable here in a concatenation to return, for instance, the approvers or the some text or some number. If I bring across the flow for the Power App, I have the Power App trigger version 2 with an input, and that's why we have on this button here, we have the requirement for an input based on the value from this dropdown. And just like before, I have the get items with the forward slash there. I have the initialize variable with our squiggly brackets. They apply to each, so that we're creating that repurposed object and obviously highlighting do not use concurrency. And then we've got some examples of retrieving the data. So the approvers is all based on that variable, but this time, rather than using the answer from the form, we're using the trigger body text, which is that text value from our trigger. We're able to query that approver's object, or array in fact, and that will return to us an array of approvers. So if we were to jump back onto this one here and have a look at the compose result, just to remind ourselves, we have an approvers array. So that's what the select is doing. It's returning approvers, which is everything in those square brackets. Then what I'm doing is, in order to just retrieve the email, I'm using a select, and you'll see this in quite a lot of my videos. I have a good video on sort of how to use JSON, so it's worth looking at, but we're using the output here from the approvers, and we're using the text mode in select to simply return the email, because I just like to return the email in my Power App. Some text, you can see it's just querying some text. Some number, same again, just some number. So the only thing really to note now is for the approvers, I'm using a join, so they're joining that array of approver emails using a semicolon, and then I've just passed the outputs from those two composes into the response to our Power App. So when we run it, if I go to play and I select option one, we should return the approvers based on that SharePoint list, which is Henrietta and Dave. And if I jump into my list, we can see we've got Henrietta and Dave. And if this was an example of an approval where we were using the approval functionality, or maybe sending an adaptive card or an email, someone goes on holiday, then we can quite quickly change who these people are to Demo Bird, and see if we can get someone else. We'll get Lynn on there as well. And if we save that, and then we go back into our Power App and run it again, we'll see that we've now got Damien and Lynn. And whilst I'm returning back this back to the Power App, it's purely just to demonstrate that we're using dynamic data in a switch kind of fashion, and really how handy objects and an understanding of expressions are when building out your flows. So that really marks the end of my demonstration. There's quite a lot to take in there. I appreciate lots of expressions, lots of ideas, but I hope that you've grasped the concept of objects and why you might want to use them when it comes to this sort of switch scenario or nested if statements. And I would love to hear in the comments how you've used this yourself. Has it helped you with a particular solution? And what else you might want to see in my videos going forward? So, if you got to the end, thanks very much for watching. Please make sure you liked and subscribed, and I look forward to seeing you again sometime soon. Cheers.